All right, are we good? Okay, great. So I'm Jana. Thanks for the intro. So I'm from Google. I'm based in our Singapore office. And I work on developing new markets for Google in the region. And that means I spend most of my time in countries which are in the early stages of leveraging the internet to drive development. So I actually spend a lot of my time here in Bangladesh, as well as Sri Lanka and Pakistan. If we look at kind of, I guess, the scope of what I do in the region, a big challenge I face is that I have to figure out how we can bring more people online in new markets. And globally today, there are 2.4 billion internet users. Sounds like a big number, right? But that's actually less than 40% of the world's population, so we're not even halfway there. And we actually believe that the next billion users are going to come from emerging markets such as Bangladesh. So that's what we'll talk about today. So we'll start with some quick trivia. Clap your hands if you know where the name Google is derived from. Okay, great. So we've got some nerds in the audience. That's great. Good news for a Googler. So the word Google is actually derived from a mathematical term that was coined in 1938. And it represents the number 10 to the power of 100. And to give you a reference point, there are about 10 to the power of 80 atoms in the known universe. So what does that mean? That means this number, Google is actually how it's pronounced, represents infinity. So why did Google name itself after a number that represents infinity? Well, it's meant to reflect the fact that there's an infinite amount of information on the internet. And as we'll discuss today, there's an infinite number of ways that this information can be used meaningfully. So this video I'm showing you, this is called the Internet Wave. This is real-time search queries coming out of countries all over the world over a 24-hour period. So a light represents searches online. And we think that this internet wave is a very good proxy for access to information. So you'll probably notice that there's some major contrasts. So if we look at, there are some countries in the world that are lit up 24 hours a day, like the US, like Japan. Then there are other parts of the world that are completely dark most of the time. If we look at the continent of Africa, it houses about a seventh of the world's population, but it's almost completely dark on this map. That means not a lot of people, a seventh of the world's population, doesn't have real-time access to information. In Bangladesh, there are today about 13 million internet users. That represents 8% internet penetration, and actually 98% of those internet users are coming from mobile phones. So it's an exciting story when you look at growth in internet penetration, but Bangladesh is fairly dark on this map. So it's not just about whether people have access to the internet. It's also, are they doing things on the internet? Are they engaged? And in order to bring more people online in emerging markets, this means we have to give people a reason to want to be online, regardless of age, country, language, socioeconomic status, religious beliefs, political affiliations, etc. It's an uphill battle. Obviously, that's a very daunting task. But there have been a lot of significant progress in early stage markets. So let's take a look at how people are using the internet in some of these emerging markets. To start a business. So in Uganda, fishermen and farmers were having difficulty accessing the physical marketplace because they had to sell their goods through middlemen. And these middlemen were effectively a bottleneck and they were cutting into their margins. So in 2010, these guys decided to empower themselves and turn to a virtual marketplace, an online marketplace. And slowly, this community online started to incubate. And this new class of SMEs started to emerge, even beyond fishermen and farmers. And we call them micro-entrepreneurs. To give you an example, one man posted a car on this online marketplace, got a call an hour later, sold the car the next day. His personal income went up 40% because he had access to this online marketplace. This is just one person. Imagine if everybody in a country was empowered to increase their personal income by 40%. Think about what that could do for economic growth. to follow elections. So this past May, there were elections in Malaysia, and the political parties decided to bring the process online, onto an online portal. And this empowered people in Malaysia to be able to access information and updates with regard to the parties, to be able to see the latest news and even watch live stream press conferences, to be able to locate polling stations, etc., effectively empowering them to be more informed voters. But beyond that, putting everything online and making it visible promoted accountability and transparency from the political parties and throughout the political arena. To solve a social problem, so there's an NGO called Samasource, and they noticed that there are about 3 billion people in the world who are actively seeking formal work, and about 1.8 billion of those people are not able to find work. So that's 60% unemployment for those of those who are seeking work. And they saw that many of these people are impoverished women and youth in countries such as India, Kenya, Haiti. And they decided they wanted to change things. So what they did was they sourced a number of global complex projects, and they broke them down into steps, very small steps that they converted to computer-based tasks. And they would bring in these women and these youth, and they would train them just on an individual step. And the concept is that throughout consistent training and feedback, and slowly growing their responsibilities, that these people would be able to launch into the formal workplace. And they found that 75% of the participants either got a promotion within this organization, were able to find a job in the formal sector full-time, or were able to save up enough money to educate themselves and go to school. If we could scale this initiative, imagine what the impact could be on the global unemployment rate. To entertain, so in Indonesia, 70 artists, 22 bands, and 7 record labels got together, and they decided that they want to crowdsource part of the creative process of making music to their wider fan base in a project that they called Share the Stage. So basically, all the artists got to choose a project. So some of them decided they were going to crowdsource writing lyrics to their songs, designing their cover album, lip-syncing, or doing covers of their songs, et cetera, et cetera. And what happened was this launched a creative and collaborative movement between artists and their fans. So for the first time, these artists were able to interact on a different level with a wider audience, and they literally reinvented the creative process. After only 3 months of this project, they got 5 million followers on a single social media platform. To manage a crisis, clap your hands if we have any mappers in the room. Do we have any mappers? Okay, we have a couple. Great. So for those of you who don't know, when you access map data, the majority of the location data on maps actually comes from the communities. And we have a very vibrant community here in Bangladesh. We also have a very vibrant community in Pakistan. And in fact, Faisalabad, the city in Pakistan, is one of the best mapped in the world. So let's take a look at what mapping looks like real time. A big thanks to the mappers in the room. So this is because of the hard work of local communities in Pakistan. So as you know, you can use maps to get from point A to point B. But you can also use maps during a crisis. And this is when it becomes really critical to have this information. So back in 2010, some of you may remember that there was massive flooding across Pakistan that caused widespread devastation. And during the flooding, the Pakistan Army and the rescue and relief agencies partnered up, and they decided that they were going to use the internet as a platform to manage this crisis. So what they did was they launched an online portal where anybody in the world could donate money, either directly to UNICEF or the Islamic Relief Fund. They also launched a portal where anybody could enter information, whether it's location information or status updates about individuals, so that people could find their friends and family. And they also used mapping data to give people insight into where there are shelters, where you can find medical assistance, etc. They even took it a step further. So they looked at satellite imagery and they analyzed cloud coverage trends hourly. Why did they do this? They did this because that allowed them to build out maps indicating which areas had already been affected, but also which areas were likely to be affected next. And throughout this crisis, 800,000 people accessed these maps. So we've just seen examples about how the internet can be used as a platform to improve lives. This is an example of the internet as a platform to save lives. To build a community. So one of the challenges with trying to evangelize the internet scalably and sustainably is that you really can't do it alone. You know, not one company can achieve this. So the answer, it seems, is to empower local communities. And we've actually got some communities here in Bangladesh who are very active. And the way community building starts is it starts with one community manager who's a volunteer and an evangelist in their own right. And they leverage international resources, be it education, be it financial resources, as well as local resources, in order to build a local community of people who are passionate about the internet. So these could be students, entrepreneurs, bloggers, developers, SMEs, whoever loves the internet and believes in what it can do. And the idea is that these communities incubate, and they get together regularly, either monthly or quarterly, to share insights into the latest trends on the web, to share success and failure stories when it comes to entrepreneurship, to meet future business partners, to do hackathons, et cetera, et cetera. And these communities started incubating at the city level. But then we realized we really need to build more of a regional community. And so these communities, for the past 2 years, across countries in Southeast Asia, have been getting together at an annual summit, where they're educated on the best practices of starting and growing a community, but also where they're given an opportunity to meet each other and share experience and learnings on how to evangelize across borders, across language, how to make the internet relevant, how to communicate the value proposition. But in order to bring the next billion users online, we need to start acting like a global community. If we think back to that internet wave, right, with all the blinking lights, the world seemed imbalanced. I mean, you have some countries that are lit up all the time and other countries that are never lit up. We've seen the infinite ways that the internet can empower individuals, communities, businesses, governments. So imagine for a minute a world that is completely lit up. Imagine what that could do socially, politically, economically. That's what we're working towards. So what does this mean for Bangladesh? Well, when I first started working here, I was very inspired by this aspiration to become a middle-income country. And I believe very strongly that the internet can be a major driver of development. But in order to drive this development, we need a critical mass of people who believe in the infinite possibilities of the internet. And so we can't do this alone. I'm going to end with a video which I find personally very inspirational. It's a humble example of how it only needs to start with one person, with one dream, to change the world.
Damn shit. sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Pleased to meet you, hope you guessed my name. But what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. Stuck around St. Petersburg when I saw it was a time for a change. Killed the Tsar and his ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a generous rank when the blitzkrieg raged and the body stank. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name. Oh yeah. I was puzzling you with the